points on the list. Leaving it here, but I still get a spread. Started with a little, but I still reinvest it. Fear how I feared, and you feel less blessed. I just want the lesson, I just want protection. I'm up and I'm down, but the sound like progression. Farmer never plans if he waits for perfection. Finger to the down, hold it.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, I got your watch list coming in at September 9th, 2021, and the stock market is rushing for protection. And I got three stocks that I'm looking at coming in at tomorrow, but I got an awesome pretty picture I want to show you. Everything we talked about yesterday, it pretty much came to life, or it kept continuing in more dramatic fashion. We are now on a three-day losing streak on the market, but everything we were talking about related to some of the banks and the peaking growth, well, we got that confirmed today. But now what a lot of people are noticing, the term structure on the VIX and the SPY and volatility, what people are paying and how they're getting into puts, we've hit a 10-year record. So I'm going to go and explain this to you. I think it could give some insight, as well as another pretty picture that we're going to have to go over. But overall, we still got a couple of events lined up. And as far as what we saw today, we actually got a decent amount of action. We're going to get a little bit more tomorrow, but depending on how it closes out, it is going to set us up for a way more exciting week next week with this CPI and then getting ready for Powell. But the big loser on the market today was the NASDAQ, down about 0.5%. You could kind of see over the last few days, it's nothing too big. We've definitely seen a lot more. This was the biggest drop on the NASDAQ in the last 2 weeks, but coming back to what we saw with the tapering and then the virus concerns before that, you're seeing everything kind of play out. It's putting us in an interesting spot, and now the economic mood is shifting, and that is what we need to talk about. So we got a lot to go over. I want to go over what happened in the market today. There was quite a few things like I just discussed and a couple more I haven't mentioned. The company news, the plays that we made today, I actually made three and I ended up making a play on TLT, and then the plays that we have for tomorrow and the rest of the week. So let us not delay. You guys know what you need to do. Drop your thumbs up on the video. Make sure you're subscribed. And if you don't know, we are live Monday through Friday, 30 minutes for open. It's the first link in the description and it's been in the comments. We better see you there in the morning. It's free 99. It costs you nothing to join. YouTube.com/thestockmarket. You can post the plays, see the plays, watch us come to life. And yes, if the name Michael and go buy a house means anything to you, then yeah, we are the place to be. And the most important thing you need to do, post or watch below. Let us know what you're looking at. Got any plays, comments, remixes, anything. Post them below and source that info. Shout out to Chad, baby. So right off the bat, like we said yesterday, that peak in growth, it somewhat got confirmed today as pretty much the morning started off. You got a bunch of banks. I believe it was 7 in total, but the big main ones, Morgan Stanley, Credit Suisse, and Citi, all of the analysts came out and they have cut U.S. stocks to underweight. So what this means, it is not like a formal downgrade. It's not like the credit agencies. It may sound worse than what it is, but the banks and how they're managing their funds, they're pretty much saying that they want to go underweight on holding U.S. equities, meaning they want to hold other stuff in more weighting. Specifically, they mentioned Europe and Japan, given that they see the risks in the U.S. market. And a lot of people now are talking about the valuations. It's one thing for growth to start slowing down, but now what comes along with that discussion is that you have a high price to earnings on the S&P, about 21 times. That is the overall peak, comparable to even 2001, 2002. So now if people are talking about growth slowing down, now people are going to start saying, well, these valuations, how long can they sustain? So you got that in the morning, and then now you even got more people getting ready for tomorrow. We're going to hear from Lagarde and the ECB, and there is now the talks or fear of them pretty much talking about tapering or actually bringing it about, because at the beginning of the week, we heard from Australia's central bank, they weren't supposed to taper. People weren't expecting them to, but they actually, in fact, ended up doing it. So depending on how that plays out, that could be the key. And then you are also getting now more updates out of Japan, Taiwan, and the Philippines. They are all backtracking and keeping their state of emergency, or at least Japan is, but they are rolling back and slowing down their economy because of the virus and some of the cases. We also got the Beige book by the end of the day. We'll talk about that, but for the most part, most of the damage was already done. We did get the jobs opening, and that did continue to increase. You now have a record amount of job vacancies and available jobs, but pretty much by the middle of the day after we got to hear from Biden, he was speaking with the auto workers unions and some of the unions there. He was talking about what they got going on. It kind of brought the market up, but then we really did not see any more action after all of that. We did see European stocks and Asian stocks go down, but all in all, this is just what we were talking about yesterday. It is now coming to fruition, and this is what what people are going to be waiting for, because now the mood is getting a little gloomy. We'll talk about that. But now the question of growth peaking is firmly in focus, and that's why next week with the CPI and anything with the Fed, that is now the second piece that we need to juggle, assuming nothing else emerges in the meantime. But coming to the first pretty picture here, this is now showing the term structure on the S&P, and it is comparing 1 month volatility to 1 year volatility, and now it's reached about 7.2-7.9%, and that is the spread between pretty much 1 month puts and 1 year puts. And they're noticing now this is the highest that it's been since 2012. So we've been talking about 2013 a little bit. It's surpassed that. But now this is just highlighting the uncertainty here in the market, because now spreads are widening and even the price on protection, both near the money, further away from the money, both short term and long term, it's highlighting that the market is kind of getting a little bit uneasy here. And like we showed about a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago, it is just highlighting this point that despite the highs that we're getting, you are still seeing this perpetual add to protection that investors are going for. So this is definitely going to be something to watch. If we do see the VIX go crazy or any other moves, this could give us a little bit more insight. But all in general, the last 48 hours and even from Friday, a lot of things have kind of shifted. If anything, hasn't been real data shifts as much as it has been attitude shifts. And I talked about this today. I don't know if it's necessarily going to lead to an immediate market move, but it does start to seem like the story is about to start changing. So we got to keep our eye out for that. And another thing today that we got, and I think a lot of people missed this one, but there was subtle China escalation. It went relatively unnoticed. But now if we come and take a look at the China stocks, they're doing the opposite of buy the dip, and they are selling the rip off of the 50-day moving average. So as you can see here from the chart, the pretty purple line there is not a Fibonacci. It's showing the 50-day moving average. And pretty much since March, anytime it's come up there, they've sold, had another tap of it right below. They sold off again. Then coming into May and June, July, that's where we saw it. Now recently, we've came up off of this bounce, but now the China stocks have not been able to get past that. So this is definitely still in full focus. And then the escalation that we got today, China fined Canada Goose, which I don't believe is a China company, which makes it all the more interesting. And they also fined H&M, but they fined Canada Goose over like false marketing claims or something like that. But one point that came up out of it is that they wanted to make a point that foreign goods are not of better quality just because they're coming outside of China. So this one was very interesting. But again, there was a lot of other things that happened in the market today, but it seems like this one was relatively ignored. Now, coming into the final point in what we saw here today, you also got that Beige book, and it essentially just confirmed this idea that the recovery is slowing down. The Fed has even said it. If you look at all the different Feds in their business context, it looks like that is the case in most places. And then linking it to the supply shortages, they're all seeing supply shortages, and they're saying this is part of it, not to mention now the wage and the labor situation, which they're saying is there is just an overall labor shortage. So now, given what we were looking at yesterday, given the fact we're getting more banks confirming, and now the Fed, that this idea of peaking growth is still on the table, you tie that in here to the year-end seasonality with September, the month alone is something you want to look at. But overall now, a lot of people are just getting ready to start punting and looking for what does next year hold, what are the expectations, how do you start to position. And even then, some people will get ready to start doing their tax loss harvesting and all of that. Don't be fooled, we're coming into the end of the year here, or the final quarter, but some people are really getting ready for the end of the year. But now tie that into those valuation concerns that we talked about, it's just overall contributing to this gloomy mood as we're getting now key CPI data next week, and then you're going to have the Fed after that. So depending on what happens in those two events, we may see the market move. But I think by the end of next week, that is going to be the real deciding factor, because now it puts us at the middle of the month expiration. That is where we've seen a lot of activity in the last 4 months in a row. So we will see what's about to happen next. But coming into the company news and events for today, the first thing, this one kind of surprised me because we were watching it, but it seems like it came out of nowhere. And I believe there is one more executive order, but Biden is kicking it off again with these executive orders. He signed one on the meatpacking packing and food industry, and it's to pretty much even out some of the prices. They talked about it where farmers are not making much, but now there's essentially price gouging going on with the meat packers. So Tyson Foods, Sanderson Farms, and a couple of other ones, even like Hormel, they all reacted to it. So that is definitely one to be watching. But we did hear stuff on that today. After hours, you got earnings from Lulu. They killed it. They beat on all ends. They went up. Sam, in this play, we got to talk about it. I got clapped on it, but they got clapped after hours as they pulled their annual forecast and even lowered their guidance below the point that pretty much dropped them the first time. And then Restoration Hardware, Warren Buffett's new favorite company, they rised after raising their 2022 revenue forecast. So that one was interesting. And then GameStop, they dipped after their quarterly loss exceeded analysts, and they refused to answer analyst questions on the call. So that one was a little interesting. But then we also heard today of talks between GameStop and AMC for a partnership on marketing. I got a question mark. It was pretty weird, but we will see how that one plays out. So watch that. Then coming into the crypto space, if you were watching last night, or even it developed throughout the night, even into this morning, Coinbase CEO called out the SEC on sketchy behavior because they wouldn't allow Coinbase to launch their lending or interest on some of their lending products. And the SEC said they would sue them. But now Mark Cuban urged Coinbase to respond aggressively. So we will see how that one plays out. But a lot of people are talking about this. That message from SEC Gensler, it is pretty much like the first shot in the war against SEC and crypto, because this is a very aggressive move on the SEC. And why? Because usually they take a proactive step and they wait for people to violate stuff and then they clap them, as opposed to getting out in front of it and then trying to threaten them. So depending on how it plays out, and this is even partly what Mark Cuban was saying, he said that Coinbase should be aggressive, because now if they do make it aggressive and force them to kind of litigate it, it could force the issue, and now the SEC will have to make a decision on what they are pretty much going to do with crypto and how they regard certain stable coins, lending, DeFi, all of that stuff. So very, very interesting. And then on the same front, we saw this news today. It sent the NFT stock surging, but Apple said that they are now allowing NFTs on the App Store. So that was pretty cool. We'll see how that one plays out. Coming into the politics, Senator Elizabeth Warren, she has urged Uber and Lyft to abandon their expected bailout measures in Massachusetts. Uber and Lyft are pretty much planning to do what they did with Prop 22 in California, but now in Massachusetts, they're trying to get stuff on the ballot so people to vote for. And Senator Warren is pretty much saying that they shouldn't go after it because it led to a bunch of problems and it gives big tech all these rights that they shouldn't have. So given how it played out last time with Prop 22, I really want to see how this affects them tomorrow morning. Then United Airlines said that they're going to be putting all of their employees that have religious exemptions for the vaccine on unpaid leave. Another crackdown here, another ramping up to get more inoculations and people going, because again, the Delta fears are kind of coming back here, and you have a lot of people overseas talking about it. So there was that. And then finally, we saw this one during the day. I think it's pretty interesting and could have a lot of medium-term to long-term effects, but Amazon is now developing a new point-of-sale system to lure sellers away from Square, Shopify, and PayPal, essentially making their own Shopify selling platform for both online and offline sales. So pretty interesting news, the good old Amazon effect. It really hasn't clapped companies in a while, but I wouldn't sleep on this, and I definitely want to watch how this one plays out. But overall, it's looking like we are getting an exciting month. Economics and the macro and what is going to be happening in those forecasts for the next few months, those are going to be key, and we have to respond accordingly. So I hope you're ready, but that is pretty much it. So let us get into the plays. So right off the bat, I got 3 or 4 different stocks that I'm looking at coming in tomorrow. I made a couple of plays on some today. We actually made 3 different plays, but the first one, I did make a play on this one, but Nike, and it is related to the goose comments that we got, that China escalation, and pretty much I'm focusing on their statement of foreign products not being of higher quality. Again, H&M has been China's main target. I don't know if you guys remember, over the last few years, they did do a targeted campaign. They really did not like H&M pretty much speaking out against the camps that they have over there. And it even led to them removing H&M and anybody who even said anything against them. They literally removed their companies off of their maps so nobody could even find them. So tying this into that escalation and seeing China fine American companies like Canadian Goose, or more so companies on on the U.S. exchange. Again, they're Canadian. But that right there, it kind of highlighted something. Like I'm saying, Nike has a decent amount to lose. So as far as the play, I decided to go with five of the Nike October 15th 130 puts. Got them at 60 cents a pop. So a decent amount, about $300 for those. 130 is the level that they were just at, or at least coming into their earnings. So it's still far out the money, but nothing too crazy. But again, their last earnings that they had, this was their jump here. So they've came down a little bit. We will see how it plays out. Remember, this was a surprising earnings that they had. So that's kind of why I like the play, but still somewhat out of the money. But in general, I really do like this play. I just think that it could develop into something depending on how this continues. And it just seems like we might be getting another wave of China escalation. So we'll see what happens. And now coming into the second play, it's on the same line of logic, but JD, I already have this play and I'm down 50% on them. They kind of went up today, but now I'm pretty much going to be looking for the double dip. JD has done the best because they have exposure to both vaccines and even medicine, as well as now the backing of like Kathy Woods and some of that stuff we saw there. That's why I was like, well, they probably got the most meat on the bone. But now you also saw some of the gaming companies questioned today or brought back into questioning in China. So they would fall into that category. I think this one has a little bit of an advantage. So again, I may be looking to double dip. And like I said here, I guess it did come up a little bit more. I thought I was down more on him, but I got those November 55s, so I could still get these at a discount. If the China stocks fail to kind of come down here, now I got a decent place marker. So I'm definitely going to be watching that depending on how the next week or so develops. So watch them. Then for the third play, like we talked about with the Amazon news, Shopify, I like the news with Amazon. Again, we usually see a bigger Amazon effect or if they're more of a direct threat, but I'm liking this play because one, it has the Amazon factor piled into it, but then also at the same time now, if we do kind of see some downward momentum continue here, I think Shop could offer a pretty decent downside play on there. So I don't have any plays on that one. I am going to be looking on that one. Just keep that one in mind. And then finally, I got Viacom here. It's kind of cutting it off so you can't see it, but I want to look at them for an upside play if the market doesn't continue its downtrend. So I put them on the watch list yesterday. I still like them for the upside. If we kind of see market momentum shift a little bit, I think they could be really, really good on the upside. So I am going to be watching them. But those are going to be the main plays as far as everything else. I still did make a couple of plays today. The first one I bought this morning, this one was disappointing. Again, I reacted to that news very, very quickly. I got it within a minute and a half of market opening, but Canada Goose, a lot of people weren't talking about it in the morning, and then pretty much the stock was down like 3, 4% pre-market, opened up only down 1%, and then proceeded to drop another 5, 6% by close. So I went with these October 30th puts for 18. I got five of them for 18 cents, just under $100. But I'm pretty sure that they ended up down 16%. I don't know how. I do. I think I just overpaid and I was just too far out the money. That's what made them overpaying. But if I went to any of the other ones, I pretty much could have snagged a decent deal. Would have been able to double up my money. So the contracts did move a little bit weird. We are very far out the money. So I will see how it plays out. But overall, I like the idea with that trade, but it just did not pan out how I expected, even though the move did end up hitting. But going to be watching that for the follow through. And then finally, I went with the small play. I spent about $200 here or $300 on TLT puts for January. And I'm a little bit cautious on the timing. I talked about this play yesterday and we talked about if we saw a repeat of the 2013 taper tantrum or just in general, if we do see the bond yields kind of top out as we saw about a month and a half ago. So I went for it, but this has been smaller than some of my other TLT plays. You guys can see here, I have these old ones for even 2023. I have those puts already. I'm down 40% on them, down 80% on the calls. Remember, we played it both ways throughout all of these bond moves. Again, the bonds have just been really sporadic throughout the whole year, but I did go a lot smaller on this play. So kind of scaling into it, going to be watching it. But overall, I like the idea. A lot of people disagree. A lot of people agree with it, but I am going to start honing in on it because just like what I've talked about yesterday, seeing some of this stuff play out even today, it is looking like the bonds are definitely going to be a big focus. So keep that in mind. But then those are the main ones as far as everything else. Going to be watching Square as well too. This one relates to the Shopify and Amazon news and even PayPal's included, but want to see how they play out. Again, they've had an interesting week with some of that positivity competing with Robinhood and all that. Then watch TSA. Again, related to the food stuff and the meatpacking, TSN was mentioned a lot during the press conference, so want to see how they play out. Sam absolutely demolished. Again, another 10%. And this one is just my fault on it. I mean, this is what I get for being complacent. Remember, we got clapped on this play. I'm down $20,000 on this play. Isn't that nuts? We were down about $10,000 or $13,000 before. We forgot to roll over. Then I got a sign. Then I said I'll deal with it later. But I was a little too complacent with it. And now it is ballooned into an even bigger loss. So as far as what I'm going to do, I got to either decide to just take the $20,000 and go home. But now this is like a bad game of poker where I've been calling. I've lost the good majority of it already now. So the question is, do we find a way to finesse it or do we just take the loss and go from there? But I will be watching them. This is definitely going to have a lot of eyes on it, and anybody even just related to this play in general, we are really going to want to watch this one. So keep your eye out for them. Then for tonight, they had news about releasing, or they got hacked and it released a lot of user data. We've seen some news like that, but hasn't really affected some of these stocks, and they have been just a real leader. So watch them. And then Nike and Goose, like we said, and then GME, I want to see how they play out. They had that back-to-back news with AMC. AMC did end up coming down with it after hours. So watch as those two play out. Then Lulu, this is a great earnings move. Very good for the retail space considering some of the earnings and growth downgrades. So this is very, very positive. I would watch out for them. And then I want to keep watching Ford. They did good. And pretty much any names that you saw do good today, keep your eye out for them. So when the market really does start to pick up, and even in general, I do want to watch Altria. They have their ex-dividend coming up here next week. But then even our UWMC, they got ex-dividend tomorrow. But you actually saw the reverse, which is very, very interesting with this one. So going to be keeping my eye out for any of these moves with X dividend or even value rotation. And then finally, TLT and the dollar. You saw it come up here. Nothing too crazy. And again, like I'm saying, my timing on this, I'm not really expecting it to happen immediately. And I think that once you see the market kind of get a hold of really what the bonds are going to do, this one is just going to be a play about responding the day before. But I am slowly adding to it. That's why I made sure I didn't put too much. But then when we come and look at the dollar, you got another increase today. It does show that it ended a little low, but throughout most of the day we were up. And what this is just highlighting now, if the growth expectations change, it might start moving things, but both bonds and dollar are elevated positions. But now I do think that TLT is going to start taking over, just given the nature of the Fed and what we got going on here. And then now, if economic projections are going to change, that is going to be reflected in bonds. I mean, the simple way to explain the play and what we said yesterday, if the economic recovery is going to be slowing down, peaked, or it has totally stopped in general, then bond yields will have to rise, or higher bond yields would indicate the opposite of that. So it is very simple, but there is a lot on the table for this next 2 weeks. It might move slow, but we are definitely going to have an action-packed month, so I hope you're ready. But that is your watch list, ladies and gentlemen. Make sure hydrate, healthy, ready to go. Make sure you post your watch list. Make sure we see you there in the morning. I need the armor on. I need the helmet shine. I need you to remember, be content. Don't try to complain. But Nicole loves you. I love you. I'm going to see you in the morning. Let's go.